Today I thought we'll talk about uptake distribution of inhaled anaesthetic agents. You have any idea why we are talking about this particular topic? Can somebody talk on this, say a few words that why we have to know about uptake and distribution? Every day we use the inhalational agents and every day we say we anaesthetize patients. Do you know what's happening to the patient when you give these drugs? Do you know what's happening? How you are reaching the target and what's happening there? How you are giving it inside and how you are taking it out and how the drug moves inside? Because it is everyday part of life, our life as well. We have to know what we are doing. So that's the idea about this class. Why should we talk about uptake and inhaled anesthetics separately? How does it differ from the intravenous drugs? Factors affecting the uptake and factors affecting distribution and elimination of inhaled anesthetics. That is what is the target for this particular class. If you take an IV anesthetic, what happens? What do? Take it in a syringe and inject it into a vein. What happens to the drug once you inject it inside? Yeah, I think they will answer. Once you inject, what happens to the drug? I want you to talk. Huh? It goes into the blood. And goes into the blood and does what? It gets distributed in the blood. Okay. Fine. So, once it gets into the blood, according to the blood circulation, then what happens? Blood circulation 75% is to the vessel rich group. That is, these are the organs which are vessel rich: kidney, lung, heart, brain, and the liver. So 75% of the blood goes into this, so it distributes into those organs. Then in the muscle group, it's about 18% of the blood goes into that. And so you have the drug going into that. Then fat is about 6% and it distributes into that. And we have the vessel poor group, that is the skeleton, that is 1% of blood goes into that. So the drug gets distributed in all these organs according to the blood supply. And it is metabolized by the liver. And it is excreted through the kidneys. There is no way you can take out the drug from the body once you have injected it inside. And understand, it has to be metabolized or it has to be eliminated through the kidneys after metabolism or free drug, whatever it is. That is how it comes out from the body. So, when you give a bolus, it gets distributed in the plasma. And you can measure that as a plasma concentration of the drug in the blood. Okay, that's the plasma concentration, you can measure it in the blood. Then the volume into which it has been distributed is called volume of distribution. This volume of distribution can be central volume of distribution and a peripheral volume of distribution. Predominantly, the first phase it distributes into the central volume. So we call it VD, volume of distribution. And it goes into the effector organ. Whichever is the target organ, it gets distributed to that. That is the first phase, it goes into that. Then it gets eliminated. Either after the metabolism or without metabolism, certain part of the drug goes out, it gets eliminated from the blood. So you get an equation saying that how this is how much I had given, this is how much has reached the target organ or the central circulation and something is going out. So if this is constant, then the behavior of the drug is different. It's not only that, then it gets distributed to the vessel rich group, all the organs take up the drug, and that's what we call as K12 is the amount of drug that is moving into those organs, and that 21 is what is coming out. So it has to reach an equilibrium with those organs, Then here in the muscle, there's a K13, that's the third compartment. And how much goes inside, how much comes out from that. So that is what indicated like that. So when you reach a steady state, we say we call that volume of distribution in steady state. Okay, see, these are the terminologies I am just introducing to you so that you will think about it. I am not going to elaborate on them. Whether you give the drug intravenously or you give the drug inhalationally, the behavior is the same once it gets into the blood. It's the same way. So you have one model compartment, you give a drug, it gets distributed and there is an elimination. Then we say the drug behaves in a zero order kinetics. Again, Priya is going to tell us what is that zero order kinetics. Yeah? Little loudly so that all of them can hear. There is no first pass metabolism, then? Drug gets eliminated at the constant rate. Whatever is the volume that is there inside, the drug constant, you are injected inside, a fixed volume of the drug gets eliminated from the system. Let's have this as a tank, water tank, and you put 5 liters of water into that, and 500 ml goes out through a tap. Then what happens? In 10 minutes, the entire tank gets emptied. Irrespective of whatever is there in the tank, 500 ml goes out, and so you get a graph which is linear. For every minute, 500 ml goes out, so you get a graph, the volume comes down here, what's going out here, so you get a straight line of elimination. That is what is zero order kinetics. Okay, I mean, body doesn't behave like that. What happens in the body, either you can have, just for understanding of the metabolism, you can talk about two compartment model or a three compartment model. When you administer the drug into the central compartment, it distributes into the peripheral compartments. We are taking everything in the body as a peripheral compartment, and some part of it is getting eliminated. Now, what is going getting eliminated is not at the constant fixed volume. It is dependent on the concentration in the central compartment. What happens to thiopentone when you inject it inside? How does it get out? Yeah? Elimination? Elimination. I am talking about the elimination. We talk about elimination as 15% of the thiopentone goes out every hour from the body. That is the capacity of the body to eliminate. We are not talking about a fixed quantity, we are talking about a percentage. So if 15% goes out by elimination, then in 1 hour from 100 it comes to 85. The second hour it doesn't become 85 to 70. It is 15% of what is remaining. So it will be around 13%. When you go to the next 1 hour, it will be about 10%. So you don't get a straight line of elimination, but you get an exponential curve which that decreases as the time goes on. Elimination, the total amount of drug that goes out also comes down. That is what is a first order kinetics. So all the drugs behave on first order kinetics, because one is because they are eliminated. Elimination is concentration dependent and metabolism dependent. So it is an exponential curve. So that is the first order kinetics. And now it is not always that we are just generalizing the entire body as one compartment other than the plasma volume, but it is, you have so many number of compartments, so many organs are there, each one of them have a different amount of uptake, each one of them have it. But for convenience sake, we always talk about a three compartment model for drug. We have one compartment which is rapidly equilibrating and one compartment which is slowly equilibrating. So we can have a better understanding. It is not that everything gets And the slow equilibration and for rapid, then there is also a difference, but we are trying to match them all together to have an understanding of that. Now, if you take this, if you put the drug into the central compartment, it gets distributed into other three departments. So you have, this is a three compartment model. This is a rapid distribution and this is a slow one. So what happens after the distribution? You said the patient recovers from thiopentone because of redistribution. Isn't right? What is that redistribution that you are talking about? As soon as you put the drug, it goes into the, rapidly it goes into the effector organ, and the concentration here raises up, and as the concentration in the central compartment comes down, there is a redistribution of the drug from that peripheral effector organ out into the central compartment. So the drug moves from here into this, and so the effect on the effector organ is coming down. So the patient recovers and patient can communicate to that level. But it does not mean the drug has gone out from the body. Okay, that is what happens. And then you have the intermediate phase in which there is a redistribution that is taking place, and along with the elimination. And finally, you have this elimination path, which is rapid, and this is intermediate, and this is slow. That is how the drug goes out. And this, they put this in, this is about 10 hours. So if you take thiopentone, even if you check it after 24 hours, you will identify some part of the drug in the blood. It will still be there because elimination continues. It doesn't come to zero. It continues like that. So even after 24 hours, you will find some amount of the drug. But only thing, it is not at the therapeutic level to cause any effect. Now, this is what happens in the IV anesthetics. Now, what happens? The same thing happens with the intravenous, I mean, of the inhalational agents also, but only thing, the mode of administration is different. Here you are giving it, you have an anesthesia machine, and then you have, you have the anesthesia machine, and then you have the breathing systems. So from the machine, you are giving a drug, and it has to go through the lung. In between, you have the breathing circuits. So what you start from here, and what happens into this, and then what happens here before it reaches the blood, forms the kinetics of inhalational anesthetic administration. After going into the blood, what happens is that there is no metabolism of these drugs that we give inhalationally. The majority of them don't get metabolized at all. And so this does not happen. And then there is no elimination through the kidneys. That's the basic difference between the intravenous agent and the inhalational agents. Whatever you give inside, whatever you give through the, this has to come out through the lungs itself. And that is what we are going to concentrate on. As the kinetics of the inhalational agents. So what happens, what are the changes that take place here when you are administering before it reaches the blood? See, IV agents, they stay as a solute in the blood, so you can measure the concentration of the drug in the, but the inhalational agent, they don't stay as a solute. They stay in the gaseous form. So you can only know the partial pressure of these. Is it possible to measure the partial pressure in the blood of these agents? It is not possible. That is why we don't attempt that. And then the tension directly correlates with the anesthetic action. So the tension is produced by the partial pressure in the blood. And it is easier to measure the alveolar concentration because it equilibrates with the blood. So we talk about concentration in the alveoli, which is almost in equilibration with the blood, and we are correlating this concentration to the brain concentration and say this is what you need for anesthetizing the patient. So that is what we call as minimal alveolar concentration, that is MAC, that is needed. So we have talked extensively about the MAC, what it is and why it is, we have to know how it is estimated, all that. So because it reflects on the blood. We are assuming that it is the same. And we talk about the factors influencing the alveolar concentration, which we are saying that it is the same as the blood. So we talk about the kinetics that affect the alveolar concentration when you administer these drugs. Okay. So what are the factors? For convenience sake, I have divided it into three sections. Factors that is affecting the inhaled tension. That is one level. The next level is factors affecting the rise in the alveolar tension. And factors affecting by the uptake by the blood. So these are the three different sections that I have divided. And I do not know whether the books give it this way these days. I don't know. Does the book talk about this in this way? The same way? Good, because I am not looking at the books. Yesterday I just had a look at the Miller 8th edition, about 40 pages. After reading 2 pages, I fell asleep. I know the same thing will happen to you. So I am just trying to simplify it for you so that you will understand the concept. And then when you read section by section, you might understand what is written in that book. Okay. Now, what are the factors affecting the inhaled tension? One is the set inspired concentration. What you set on the machine, either the gases or the inhalational agent, whatever you set on the machine, that is the first thing that affects how much is going to go inside. It might get modified on the way, a lot of things, but one of the factors that affect the inhaled tension is the set. If you set 6%, it is going to be reflected on the breathing circuit and down to the blood. If you set 1%, it is going to be less. So this is one factor which controls how much the patient is going to inhale. And then you have the fresh gas delivery port. We talked about the breathing circuit, and then one of the essential requirement of a breathing system we said is whatever you deliver from the machine should reflect on the patient's alveoli as fast as possible. That is what we have said as a requirement. And here if you see, if the fresh gas is delivered here near the patient, near the lung, then whatever you set is likely to reflect, and so it is one factor that affects the inhaled tension. If the gas is going to be delivered here, it is going to be diluted in the circuit, then that is going to alter how much is going to reach the alveoli. So this is the next factor. Fresh gas delivery point into the circuit affects the inhaled tension. Okay. Now, next is the breathing circuit volume. We talk about, I mean, this is a circle system. You see that this is quite a big, thick tubes. If you calculate the volume of this, each one is supposed to be about 600 ml, so the two liters plus this 2 liters plus 2 liters. So you have about 6 liters of volume into which the gas or the anesthetic is being delivered into. It gets diluted in that, it circulates in that. So this is another factor that affects how much is reaching the patient's alveoli. So if the same thing is just about 3 liters, then the dilution is less, so whatever is reaching the patient will be faster. So if the volume is more, then it takes a longer time for it to reflect. So the factors affecting the inhaled tension, one of this is this. And you have one more factor, that is rubber gas solubility. We talk about this because in our times we used to use only the tubes that are made of rubber, black. So they absorb certain amount of the anesthetics. Now we have switched over to this PVC tubes, and the absorption by this is very minimal. So that does not form a part of it, but those days, because of the black rubber tubes, they absorb, and that also another factor which affects the inhaled tension. So these are the 4 factors that you will have to keep in mind. So those are the 4 things. Then factors affecting the rise in alveolar tension. So it has come into the circuit, and so you have a certain concentration in the circuit, and then your patient is inhaling it into the alveoli. So what are the factors that affect the rise in the alveolar tension? One is alveolar ventilation. What does it mean? See, we said if you are ventilating the patient or breathing with the 4 liter alveolar ventilation, the amount of anesthetic that is taken up by transported from the breathing circuit into the alveoli will be certain amount. If the same thing is 8 liters of alveoli ventilation, then the amount of anesthetic that will be delivered from the circuit into the alveoli will double. So that is why, and if you reduce it, say if the ventilation is only 2 liters, then the amount of anesthetic that reaches the alveoli is half of what it was when it is 4 liters. So this is one factor. So alveolar ventilation can affect the rate of rise of tension in the alveoli. So if you hyperventilate, then more of the anesthetic will go inside. If you hypoventilate, less of the anesthetic will go inside the alveoli. Same way with the patient is breathing spontaneously, if a person is hyperventilating, then it will reach faster. If the patient depressed with all narcotics and inhalational agents and intravenous agents and does not breathe, the rate of rise of this tension is going to be slow. So if you had given fentanyl and you had given propofol and then the patient stops breathing, then no anesthetic will reach the alveoli and into the blood. You understand what's the implication? Till you ventilate and then till you start pushing it inside and till you get the tension to rise in the alveoli, the patient is not going to be anesthetized by the inhalational agents. Second one, we talk about the factors affecting is a concentration effect. What is this concentration? We'll just look at these two factors. What is the effect of ventilation? See, if we ignore uptake, there's nothing, whatever you are giving from the circuit into the alveoli, there's nothing is being taken up by the blood. If you take that assumption, then if the FRC is 2 liters, and I'm just putting it as a nitrous oxide, it could be helium or anything. This is just, I'm putting it as a marker. It's not that we are going to give 100% nitrous oxide. And if the tidal volume is 500 ml and the patient is breathing at 10 breaths per minute, what happens in the first breath? 500 ml, so it forms 20% of nitrous oxide. And so the total volume becomes 2500. And what comes out after the first breath is 500 ml of 100 ml of the nitrous oxide comes out. So finally, what is the concentration of the nitrous oxide that is there inside? How much is it? It is 20%. Because it will be 400 ml in 2000 ml. So you have reached a 20% level in the alveoli. So if this process continues, each breath you are putting this much of amount, 500, and then at the end of 1 minute, you will have 86% nitrous oxide in the alveoli. Understand what it is? It is not that you ventilate with 100% nitrous oxide, the patient gets 100% nitrous oxide. There is a mixture that is taking place in the FRC, and that mixture controls what is the rate of rise of this tension in the alveoli. So I am using this as a marker only to explain to you this process. Because if you take the second breath, it will be 2000 ml in which 100 ml of 400 ml of nitrous oxide is there, then another 500 ml is added. So you will have 900 ml of nitrous oxide and 1600 ml of the other gas. And when it comes out, 100 ml will come out. So finally, what you will be left with is 800 ml of nitrous oxide and remaining gases. So the percentage will not go up to 50% or 40% of double of this. It will go up to only 35%. So that's why I said it is an exponential curve, and rate of rise is exponential and depending on the time constant. What is the time constant? We'll talk about all that a little later when we do the gas man. So it is exponential. Just remember, it is exponential. So I said doubling the ventilation will halve the time constant, and at desired level will be reached faster. The effect is limited only by the lung volume. Higher the FRC, slower will be the rate of rise of and vice versa. Why do children get anesthetized faster? Because the FRC is less and they hyperventilate when you try to induce them inhalationally. So the rate of rise in the alveoli is much faster because the volume that they take inside compared to the FRC that is there is maybe is 1:1. So when they take a deep breath, they almost take up to FRC. So in that rate, if they breathe, the alveolar tension goes up much faster and so they get anesthetized much faster. But it's an adult, it is not so. Because the FRC is high and then the volume that goes inside is proportional and it takes time for them to get anesthetized. That is why we prefer to do an inhalational induction in children. Even if they are a little bit agitated and starts crying, then it's much better because they breathe much deeper and they get knocked out in 2-3 breaths. Okay. So what is this concentration effect? You just imagine this calculation. We have 800 ml, we are administering this alveolar ventilation, 80% nitrous oxide and 19% oxygen and 1% of second gas. Again, for making the concept clear, that is all. This is the alveolar ventilation. So, if you give this, if goes into the patient, 50% of the nitrous oxide is taken up by the blood. What happens inside the alveoli? So the 50% of the 1,600 ml has been taken up. So you are left with 2,400 ml in the alveoli. And the composition is, we are assuming that no oxygen is taken up. Okay, 1,600 ml of nitrous oxide, 800 ml of oxygen, and whatever it is there. So that's what happens. Nitrous oxide becomes 67%, oxygen becomes 32%, and that gas is 1%. Okay. You find that the concentration of this particular agent that is being taken up, that has gone up, not down. It has gone up because the volume is depleted. And whatever is the other one, the concentration of that also goes up. So this is what we call as a concentration effect. Okay, this is not as simple as what I am trying to show you. It is more complicated. Okay, now if you take this 2400 ml, put it up there, 40%, 19% of oxygen and 1%. Can the lung remain collapsed like that because the gas is taken up? It doesn't remain collapsed. It doesn't collapse like that. There is an augmented ventilation because the gas is going out. There is a movement of gas from the anesthetic circuit or from the atmosphere into the lung. Continuously, there is augmented ventilation. It is not that when you take a breath that it goes and then distributes. Even when the gases are being taken up, there is a movement of gas from the circuit into the patient's lung. So that is called augmented ventilation. And so absorbed gas is replaced by an augmented ventilation. So the 1600 ml gets replaced by the same concentration of the drug, of the gases. So when you add up that 1600 ml of the same percentage, then what happens? Finally, what you get is, this will be 32% nitrous oxide and then 7.6% of oxygen. So of the total, if you take, what is there of nitrous oxide is 72%, it is not, what is there of oxygen will be around 26%. This is what we call as a concentration effect of a movement of anesthetic gases. What happens to the gas, that second gas that is there, this is 1%, with the augmented ventilation, another 0.4% of the gas goes inside along with that. And in the alveoli, the concentration of the second gas goes to 1.4%. It is not 1%. This is what we call as second gas effect. Now, this kind of movement takes place only when you have an agent which is being taken up very fast, like nitrous oxide. When there is a very fast movement of gases across the alveoli to the blood, then this kind of concentration and second gas effects will take place. Okay, remember this model assumes oxygen is not taken up, the agent is not taken up, nothing. So it's only nitrous oxide is being taken up. So this is assuming that. But this has been made to make you understand the concept of what we mean by a concentration effect and what we mean by a second gas effect. What actually happens in the patient will be a little more proportional to whatever happens, and it is likely to vary. And this happens predominantly at the time of induction, when there is a very fast movement of nitrous oxide from the alveoli into the blood. And after there is a equilibration, all this does not happen. Okay. Any doubts up to this? Any doubts? Yeah. Okay, the third thing we said is uptake by the blood. Third factor that is going to affect is the uptake by the blood. What are the factors that facilitate uptake? One is the blood gas solubility of the drug, then the cardiac output, then the alveolar venous gradient. These are the three factors that affect the movement of the anesthetic from the alveoli into the blood. What do you mean by this? So this uptake is dependent on three parameters. This lambda into Q into PA minus PV by barometric pressure. What does this stand for? What is that? Blood gas solubility coefficient. And this one is cardiac output. And this is arterial to venous partial pressure difference of the agent. Okay, alveolar to venous gradient, that is what? Okay, alveolar to venous. Capital A represents alveolar, small a represents arterial. Okay? Since the uptake is a product of three factors, if one of them becomes near zero, the uptake itself will be going towards zero. So, which can become zero in this? Cardiac output cannot become zero. Solubility cannot become zero. Then the one factor that is remaining is the gradient between alveoli and the venous tensions. So that can keep decreasing according to the behavior of the drug. So what is solubility? We said blood gas solubility is one factor. It indicates the affinity of the agent to dissolve in the blood. When you inject a drug intravenously, it gets inside. What happens to that drug? We said it remains as a solute. Is that all? What happens to the drug when you inject inside? According to the level of protein binding, some of the drug will be bound to the proteins. Okay, so we call that protein binding capacity of the drug when we talk about intravenous agents. Whereas when you talk about this inhalational agent, we talk about a solubility. That means it is because it's only the undissolved only can exert a partial pressure. Whatever is remaining as a gas only can produce a partial pressure, and whatever gets dissolved into the blood cannot exert a pressure and cannot affect the organs. So whatever goes into the blood and gets dissolved is called the solubility of the particular agent. Understand? Higher the solubility, slower will be the development of partial pressure. Only the alveolar partial pressure will reflect on the brain through the blood. So what is the solubility of sevoflurane? What is it about desflurane? That's what you people use now. You are not looking at halothane or ether, methoxyflurane, nothing. You only look at isoflurane, nothing. You don't think about what is it about what's the solubility of sevoflurane and then desflurane? Okay. Sevo? Now, you have to be like that when you talk about solubility, because these will be maybe a common question when you have an IVA. What's the solubility you are talking about? And you have to come out with the numbers. Yeah, who is going to? She's sitting on this side kindly. Yeah? How much solubility for desflurane? What's the solubility for CO? 0.47 for desflurane. And CO? 0.65. Okay, 0.65. Okay, this is what is the solubility of these agents. 0.65 for sevoflurane, 0.45 for desflurane. Isoflurane is 1.4, halothane is 2.4. If you take diethyl ether, it is 12, and methoxyflurane, it is 11, which means till 12 parts of the agent is dissolved into the blood, it is not going to exert any pressure, partial pressure on the tissues. So that means you have to give that much amount of an agent for it to exert a very little effect. That's what it means. And because these agents are potent, methoxyflurane is a very potent agent, with that concentration we are able to anesthetize them. That is a different factor. But 11 parts of methoxyflurane has to dissolve into the blood for it to exert one level of partial pressure. Whereas here it is, if you take xenon, it is 0.14, nitrous oxide it is 0.47, desflurane it is 0.45. That is why, because nothing much is dissolved, the tension can rise much faster in the blood. So it keeps increasing. So I say that we are looking at what are the factors that affect FA by FI. Because if there is an uptake, then the alveolar tension is going to go down. So finally, what are the factors that affect the fraction in the alveoli? This is what is coming from the circuit, this is what is in the alveoli, and then we said, one we already said is alveolar ventilation, then we talked about solubility, and then we'll go on to talk about the cardiac output and the gradient. These are the other two factors. Now, this I took it from the Miller. This is a graph that is produced to show what here they have used a word, they have not used a fraction FA and FI, but they have used partial pressure in the alveoli by partial pressure in the circuit. That is what they have put it as on this side and the y-axis. And this is the rate of rise of the agents to the level, peak level. So what happens? This is methoxyflurane and that is desflurane. This is sevoflurane, iso and halothane. What is it? The rate of rise of alveolar tension is much faster. It is up to 0.8 with the desflurane. What does it mean finally? If the rate of rise in the alveoli is faster, what do you interpret it as? Uptake is less. Uptake is more. Now, I want a different interpretation for this. Solubility is low. 0.45 is the solubility. That's what is shown here. 0.45 is the blood gas solubility. And the rate of rise of alveolar tension is much faster. So the patients will get anesthetized faster because we are saying that we are equating the alveolar tension to the brain tension. So if the alveolar tension goes up much faster, the patient gets anesthetized much faster. So if the blood gas solubility is slow, then the rate of induction is much faster. If the blood gas solubility is high, then it has not even reached 0.2. So what about the anesthetic action? In about 30 minutes, it has reached only up to 0.2. So you are going to need a much higher concentration to anesthetize. So we don't use methoxyflurane so much as we did not use rather methoxyflurane as an anesthetic, but it was used for analgesic properties, a very good analgesic. So it is used in obstetric analgesia and as a supplement for giving very good analgesia. That is what it is used for, not as a sole anesthetic. Whereas ether, it's not plotted here. Ether is, though the solubility is high, it's about 12, it had the property of anesthetizing because it can reach the tension and then produce that anesthetic state. So it is used for we used to increase the concentration and then use it. Methoxyfluorine, if you keep increasing the concentration to reach an anesthetic level, what is the side effect? With the failure, John. Methoxyfluorine, what is, if you keep giving more of methoxyfluorine, what happens? Why did we not choose that way? We did that for ether. Yeah, renal toxicity, because it dissociates and gives free fluoride ions, then the renal toxicity is high. That is why it was not favored. It is used for as an analgesic, yes, but not an anesthetic. That also prolonged period of time as an analgesic was also not very much advocated, so it has gone out now. No more we are using methoxyfluorine. And this has been depicted with a fresh gas flow of 50 liters in open circuit or non-rebreathing circuit. So you say that this is showing the rate of rise. When you are using a rebreathing circuit or circle system kind of thing, then the rate of rise is slower than that. You see it has reached up to 0.9 here, but it is not so much. There's a difference between at the rate of rise itself. So the amount of rebreathing that you allow and the concentration also affects the rate of rise of FA by FI. Understand? Okay, let's look at a cardiac output. What is the effect of cardiac output? We have the inspired fraction, and then we have that is constant. And we have the alveolar tension. So these two that we have talked about, these two. If there is a decreased cardiac output, what happens? Uptake by the blood from the alveoli comes down, because the blood that is coming there itself is less. Amount of agent that is taken up by the blood and going out also is less. So the uptake becomes less. When the uptake becomes less, what happens? And the amount of agent that is leaving the alveoli is less, then what happens to the alveolar tension? It increases. So the alveolar tension increases. Okay, and we are equating this alveolar tension to the brain tension. And so that we say if the cardiac output is less, then the patient gets anesthetized faster. That is what used to be told. Okay, is that true? I'm just putting it across to you. Is that true? You will have to think about it, and we'll have the answers to that a little later. Same way, if the cardiac output increased, then the uptake of the agent from the alveoli is increased, and you find alveolar tension comes down. All that we are measuring in our machines is the alveolar tension as an end-tidal concentration of the agent. This is what we are looking at, and then we say this is what the brain is getting. Are we doing justice to whatever we are thinking in our mind by looking at the values? I am saying end-tidal concentration is 1.5, so this patient is at this particular state. So cardiac output is one that alters the reflection of the alveolar tension onto the brain. How far it differs. For calculating all that, we need to have a computerized model. Only then we can understand all that. That is why we are saying that we will have a workshop on GASMAN, which is a computerized simulation model, which will give you an explanation for what happens and how it happens. That is the idea of trying to do that particular workshop next week. When is it? Next week, 23rd. Okay. Now, what about the alveolar to venous anesthetic gradient? You have the alveolar tension here. Then, the other side, you have the tissue uptake. When it goes out, we said each tissue differently takes up the agent according to the capacity of that for interaction with that, and that is the tissue gas solubility. And so, and it takes up and it comes back into the venous side. And that venous side is reflected as fraction in the venous side. And you have the alveolar and you have the arterial. Now, if this fraction comes down, difference between the venous and the artery and the alveolar comes down. When does it come down? When this uptake reaches the equilibrium, whatever goes into the tissues, nothing is taken up, it comes back into the venous side and then it comes back into the lung. So as time goes on, the tissue uptake comes down, and so the venous tension comes down. Venous and the alveoli also comes down. So the uptake of the drug from the alveoli becomes less. Initially, in the initial phase when you are inducing, tissue uptake is more, and then so whatever coming back into the venous side will be much, much less, so the gradient will be much more. Okay. So if there's no tissue uptake, FE will be more and the gradient is less, so the uptake will be less. You understand that cycle? Okay, let's look at the distribution. So we are giving the anesthetic from the machine. And this is a water analog that is used by Mapleson. And still, if you look at the books, they'll be using this particular analog to tell you, to explain to you how things move. So this is, let's say this is the mask, breathing circuit and the mask. Then it goes into the, you open that and the patient starts breathing, it goes into the lungs. So we talked about FI and FA, the difference, the rate of rise of this FA. We talked about the factors that affect that. And from here, it gets distributed to the vessel-rich group, the muscle, and the fat. We said three compartments. One, actually, these two are equated, and this is, we say this is one, this is two, and this is three. That is our three-compartment model. If you look at this, this will become four-compartment model. If you, the lung, VRG, muscle, and fat, then this becomes, because lung also takes up. Okay, so this is what it is. According to the amount of blood flow and according to the solubility, according to all other factors, something moves here, something moves here, something moves here, and it depends on the blood flow. And what is the other factor? Tissue solubility of the drug. What is the tissue solubility of this? You look at it, methoxyfluorine is 670 in the adipose tissue. So it just sucks up. Whatever comes in the blood, it just sucks up and stays in the fat. And for xenon, it is 1.3. And for sevoflurane, 2.3. And then desflurane, it is 27. Isoflurane, 64. So that is how the fat absorbs, even though the blood supply to that is much less, only 6%. If you take the vessel-rich group and then the muscles, these are the tissue gas solubility coefficient. You find here it is 1.3 and 2, 1.7 and 1.2. And for nitrous oxide, 0.46, 0.4. And so these agents behave differently from these agents which have much more affinity for the tissues, especially in the elimination phase. Okay, so if you have anesthetized with the methoxyfluorine for a longer time, it takes all ether, it takes much longer, diethyl ether, it is 50, but chloroform 280 and halothane 185. It takes much longer for them to recover because the drug is there in that as a depot and keeps coming back into the circulation and gets eliminated. So if you look at the nitrous oxide, desflurane and sevoflurane, which are low soluble agent, it goes in the, then in the lung it goes up faster, then vessel rich group it reaches much faster, the muscle it is less, and then in the fat it is much less. The fat compartment is shown as a small one because not much of the drug is being absorbed, whether it is only 1.1, 2.3 and 27. In the muscle 0.4, 2 and 1 point, so it is almost equivalent to that. So that is how it is depicted. So when it is going out, what is to go out from here is much less. So if you take halothane, you find this is 155, it is depicted as such a big vessel, and the rate of rise in that is much slower, but it takes up much more. and the muscle is 6 and vessel rich group is 2.5. You find the size of the vessels represent the solubility, and the size of these tubes represent the blood flow into them. That is how this analog is depicted. So you find, yes, vessel rich group, it goes up, the muscle and fat, it's a large capacity for absorbing. So this is what it is, because of tissue gas solubility. So when you keep giving, the tissue will keep on taking it up, so the gradient will remain high in the venous side, so uptake will be more, so that will continue. Whereas in the other group, if you see, you reach almost a primary equilibration with the body in a very short time. Like nitrous oxide, desflurane, sevoflurane, in about 20 minutes time, you might reach a primary saturation. What we mean by that primary saturation is, what is it? What we mean by that primary saturation is this, maybe plus this. In about 20 minutes, you will reach that saturation. After that, not much of an agent will be taken up, whereas primary saturation with other anaesthetics, it takes a longer time. And the secondary saturation or total saturation of the body never takes place, because the agent is being taken up by the fat and muscles continuously. They don't reach a complete. So that's about primary saturation. Nitrous oxide in about 20 minutes, or even with the desflurane, maybe a same amount of time, you will reach a primary saturation. After that, whatever drug you give into the patient, it's going to come out in the circuit. It will go to the lung and come back. It will be circulating only here. Nothing will be taken up by the body, because they have already reached a saturation point. So elimination is a reversal of the induction process. FRC washout by ventilation is rapid. Then 90 to 95% of nitrous oxide removed in 2 minutes. When you remove it, when you allow the patient to breathe spontaneously, the diffusion hypoxia has to be kept in mind, because there is a fast movement of nitrous oxide from the blood down to the alveoli. And so because of that, we talked about the concentrating effect. The nitrous oxide concentration will go up, oxygen concentration will fall down. So there is a possibility of having a hypoxia if you are not administering additional oxygen at that particular time. So that is called the diffusion hypoxia. So there are 3 major differences between induction and recovery. What are these? So recovery from the inhalational agent has to take place in the same way. It has to go out from here to the lung, from the lung into the circuit, and then it won't go to the machine, it has to go out into the atmosphere. So that's the direction it has to go, because it is not metabolized, it is not eliminated by the kidneys, it has to come out of the body. If the solubility is high, it can be overcome by overpressure during induction. What I mean by that, if a ether, if you are going to give, even though the, what is the MAC of ether? Okay, what's the MAC for halothane? 0.7. What's the MAC for sevoflurane? 2. So if you start giving 6% sevoflurane, you can reach that 2 much faster. That is called an overpressure. You are driving it with a much higher concentration so that you can reach whatever level that you want much faster. But during elimination, that is not possible, because it has to, the body has got a concentration in the tissues, and that from that only it has to come out. So the concentration gradient between the tissue and the blood is going to determine how fast it is going to come out. The tissues have the same partial pressure at induction, that is, there is nothing, 0. So the uptake is fast. But the partial pressure differs in the tissues at the end of anesthetic. So the different partial pressures. So according to the partial pressure difference between them, it is going to move out. So you have absolutely no control on that. It is only the solubility of the agent that determines how the agent moves out from the tissues. And then recovery does not take place with removal of same amount of anesthetic. You say, I have given such that much, I have taken out this much, so the patient should recover. It does not happen that way. It is context sensitive. If you are given it for a long period of time, it takes a longer time for the patient to recover when the agent is more soluble. And it is similar behavior will be there, but it might be a little more faster with the other agents. But it is context sensitive, and we find that with desflurane, the time remains almost similar even if you have anesthetized for a long period of time. With sevoflurane, there might be a little difference. But with isoflurane, halothane, it gets much prolonged. You will have to understand that process when you are finishing the case.